Welcome to this video on the summary and consequences to be drawn from the entire video series in this playlist on our successful future. Here I only want to summarize them, mention some of the interrelations and some of the major results, all the assumptions and many more interrelations are presented in the more detailed longer videos in this playlist. The questions with which I want to deal in this video are: how can we master the grand challenges of humanity? And with the grand challenges, I mean especially the undernourishment or the hunger in the world, climate change, and linked to that, the sustainable energy transition. The specific question that needs to be answered is, what do we need to do politically or individually to master these challenges? The basis for the considerations are quantitative interrelations between some major aspects of sustainability, which I will present in the following. I should say that, as compared to the other videos in this playlist, some of the diagrams have been newly evaluated, slightly redrawn, but the results are essentially identical. The background for the entire considerations is shown here, more or less. We see here the temperature color-coded as a function of time. And we see that during the last few decades, temperature increased significantly up to around now of the order of 1 degree centigrade above pre-industrial level. And we see that that actually happened mostly during the last few decades. Cause for that is typically assumed to be the increasing concentration of the carbon dioxide in parts per million in the atmosphere as a function of time, drawn here where we see the data in blue, and it's drawn logarithmically with respect to the pre-industrial level, which means that if we see here a linear curve during the several decades, that means that actually the CO2 concentration is increasing exponentially. If we continue that exponential growth, we see that the climate goals on which we agreed internationally with the Paris Agreement in 2015, we will to 2 degrees or 1.5 degrees, we try to manage possibly 1.5 degrees, and that will be achieved if we continue as in the past. We will reach that quite soon, within 2 to 3 decades. In turn, this means that we need to foster energy transition or master energy transition within a few decades as well. That defines the time scale on which we need to act. Okay, that's that. That's the background. Now the question is, of course, how can we somehow tackle this problem? How can we approach that, so that we can understand what's going on? Well, the first thing that we need to realize is that the key variable in the entire system is world population. Why? Well, world population defines everything. The more people we are, the more food we need, the more energy we need, the more waste we produce, the more CO2 we emit into the atmosphere. So the world population is the key variable in this entire system. Where do we get information on world population from? Well, one way to obtain data is by the United Nations. They have a statistics department which publishes the world population as a function of time, the historical data on the one hand side, on the other hand side, projection into the future, with the high variant, the medium variant, and the low variant. The medium variant is evaluated in all detail, and that's typically assumed to be the most probable value. Recently, they also published probabilities for that, and there one can see that the medium variant is the most likely scenario to occur. The two others are essentially very unlikely. So that spread, so to speak, covers the entire range that is to be expected, even up to very extreme values. Okay, so this is how it looks like. Now the point is actually that I've been evaluating these data since more than a decade meanwhile, and I was irritated a little bit, because when I started my considerations and working with that, I realized that the medium variant was looking differently. And so what I did in order to analyze what happens with this variable, and since we saw it's a key variable, it's important that we know something about the uncertainty of that system, what to expect for variations in that system, in that variable. I looked at the data for 2050 and plotted the values for 2050, so these three values for 2050, but related to when these data have been published. United Nations updates them every 2 years roughly, shown here between 1996 and the value or the version of 2017. And one sees that now that from publication to publication, for the low and the medium variant, the values have always been increasing. And now I'm an engineer. What I do, I plot a straight line through that. Okay. We also realize that these three lines should possibly meet in 2050, because in 2050, predicting the value for 2050, it's not really a prediction. It is more or less just looking which value we have. It's counting, so to speak, how many people are around in 2050, plus minus some uncertainty, because it's an estimate, presumably, but that is minor. So we can assume that it's more or less one point, and these three curves have to pass through that single point. Then the slope of these three lines and this point have been fitted to the data between 2000 and 2017, and what we reach is 11.6 billion in 2050. And now we can look what this value actually means, and we can plot that value in the previous diagram. If we do that together with the corresponding curve through that, we can see that we will reach a value which is even above the high variant. And I just said previously that the high variant is already regarded as being rather unlikely to occur. And nevertheless, the question is, of course, how can that be? How can we understand that the United Nations says that this variant is most likely to occur? And we see by this meta-study, to see how the studies, so to speak, develop over time, that we then reach that value or that curve. How can that be? In order to understand that, we have to realize that we are predicting the future. And actually, we can't predict the future. It's impossible. As one says, the future is open. Individual decisions, individual situations may change the future completely. If there is a global economic crisis, that will change the behavior here. If there are some elections in some major country where somebody else is elected, different options that can occur, that can influence that as well. Because that influences world economy, that influences wealth in the countries, that influences the number of children that people have, etc., and that directly has influences here. That means, of course, this inability to predict the future, that means that we need to take two different terms into account, two different effects into account. On the one hand side, the uncertainty, which relates to known possible errors, which can be quantified or at least estimated. For example, we know from a certain country that the number of people that are published in the official documents has a certain uncertainty, plus minus some thousand, for example. We know that, and we can account for that in the estimate that we make, and can figure out how much our final result will depend on these things. The second aspect is a so-called ignorance. It's just a lack of knowledge. We don't know how the future will develop in this case. That will, if we look at a given time and do predictions for that, that will of course decrease over time as we approach that point in time. And it can unfortunately not be quantified. In principle, it cannot be quantified. We only can get some idea of the order of magnitude of that if we do such a meta-study, where we realize, for example, that in the previous estimates by the United Nations, the child mortality was underestimated, the population growth in the sub-Saharan countries was underestimated, and the effect of AIDS was overestimated. And since we know, meanwhile, it didn't turn out the way it was originally thought to turn to behave, we know that meanwhile, so we gained some knowledge, the lack of knowledge decreased over time, we now have better estimates. But it is not said at all that this trend will not continue into the future, that we will always realize new effects that will continue to shift up the expectations into higher values in world population. That means in turn that if we look now at the overall ignorance that can occur, our lack of knowledge, and it's not some deficit of the United Nations, it's very fundamentally impossible to predict the future. That means that actually we have to take the scenarios into account between the medium variant and that extrapolated version, so to speak, up here. This is as realistic as well if our increase in knowledge continues as in the past. Then we will be winding up with 11.6 billion people in 2050 as compared to this medium variant where we would have only 9.8 billion, which is roughly 2 billion more than today. And we can have an additional almost 2 billion more, possibly. So there's a quite wide variation possible with respect to world population. Now, in order to guide policies, to guide politics, we would, of course, like to take this entire situation into account, also the worst case and not only the optimum case. That is all that would need to be considered, so also the upper curve, more or less, as being a realistic picture of the future development. Unfortunately, if you look at the studies that are published for guiding politics, actually it's the basis for the EU policies, it's for the sustainable policies, so sustainability policies published in November 2018, they use this population variant, this pink one, this or magenta one down here. And we see it's on the lower level, but they don't take into account a worst case. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, who are, so to speak, the high-ranked body that of which we assume that it does the best studies, more or less, or collects the best studies into condenses that into best knowledge. We see that they have a much lower population growth accounted for, and the Club of Rome is even below that. Now, what does that mean? If we assume too few people, we need less food, we need less land area for food production, which means we have more land area available for example, bioenergy, or for afforestation in order to recover CO2 from the atmosphere, or to ensure biodiversity. All that would be possible down here, but if you have more people, we first need to feed the people and all this nice bio stuff that is not possible to that extent anymore. That is, these policies that build on these scenarios always have a much too optimistic view, also much too optimistic view with respect to sustainable energy transition, as well as with respect to world hunger. And I want to discuss this, especially this effect on world hunger, because I want to make clear how important these numbers actually are. Reference year for for the sustainability goals of the United Nations is the year 1990, and since 1990 up to today, the number of people increased, the population growth increased, the world population increased by 2.3 billion people. One number. The second number, if you look at the number of undernourished people, is that since 1990, we decreased the number of undernourished people from 1 billion to 800 million, so by 200 million. That is, overall, we are feeding 2.3 billion people plus 200 million people more today as compared to 1990. Okay, so we feed today, during these years, 30 years, we managed to feed additional people 2.5 billion. Unfortunately, population increased by 2.3 billion. It was one of the numbers I mentioned already, so that undernourishment increased only, or the number of undernourished people decreased only by 200 million. We see actually that agricultural productivity has significantly increased. We feed now 2.5 billion people more than 1990. That's the progress in agriculture, apparently. But population growth ate that up directly, more or less directly. So that in the end, the number of undernourished people only slightly decreased. And of course, if we now see that uncertainty with respect to the future, that we can have between almost 2 or almost 4 billion people more by 2050 as compared to today, we see that that difference, of course, has an influence on undernourishment quite dramatically, directly. That's one thing. Another thing that I want to mention is that we look now at the causes for that, why the population is growing so fast, and this can be expressed as a fertility in children per woman, or if you like, children per couple, as a function of gross domestic product per capita, that is US dollars per capita and year, for different countries. And the size of the circles refers to the population in the corresponding country. And we see that if there's a certain limit exceeded, say around 3,000 US dollars per person and year, that then the fertility, the number of children per couple, is of the order of 2. And of course, 2 children are sustainable, 2 parents are on the long term replaced by 2 children, that sustainable world population would stabilize. But unfortunately, we have a quite large number of countries, low-income countries apparently, where the number of children per couple are significantly higher. For Nigeria, just to mention one example, one can use any, but let's take that. We have 6 children per couple, which means actually, since these people are quite young, the parents are quite young typically, that also the parents will be living, and in one generation, say 25, 30 years, these 2 people have 6 children, that is, we quadrupled the population. But possibly it will not exactly be four, it will be between three and four, because some people died, the grandparents died meanwhile, possibly. So it will be somewhere of that order of three to four that the population increases. That means that circle will be increasing. And that has, of course, detrimental effects. You will see later that feeding the people, or we just saw that before already, that it's critical. And of course, in the poor countries, feeding the people is difficult. But if on the other hand side, especially in poor countries, the number of people is increasing excessively, that means that the number of hungry people are increasing significantly, it can be that we can come to a situation where the developed countries are no longer able to feed all those people in those poor countries, even though they put lots of effort into crisis intervention and things like that. So that means there is a tipping point possible, a developmental tipping point possible for the future development if we don't take care of that. On the other hand side, if you want to decrease population growth, we directly see that we should develop countries, because as they move to the right, they have more income, economy is functioning better. Then actually we see directly the number of children will decrease down to sustainable 2 children per couple. What does that mean for us? Why is it important for us to foster development of less developed regions? For a very simple reason, this difference in, well, income, in wealth, in standard of living, in way of life, is of course a significant driving force for migration. And of course, our economies can only take a certain number of migrants. There's somewhere a limit, we don't know, society has to agree on that, I can't say that, but there will be some limit possibly. But we have to realize, as the difference between poor and rich countries is increasing, also the driving force for migration is increasing. And now I'm a chemical engineer, I can tell you something about the experiences that we have with transport processes, different transport processes, and these are very general insights. And so I want to share them, and I want to then apply them to the transport of people migration. The experiment is a kitchen experiment. I have a pan, I have a thin layer of silicon oil, some aluminum particles added to see what's going on more or less. And if I heat that pan from below at a low heating rate, what actually happens is that the heat is conducted through that layer of the silicon oil and is then dissipated into the air. So it's just heat conduction through the thin layer, nothing happens, everything is at rest, everything is quite peaceful. But as we increase the setting of the heating device, so this, you see it's a 7, which is quite large, which is quite high number, strong heating. What then happens is shown on the next presentation, next slide, I hope one can see that also in the video later. We see that so-called roll cells are occurring. It's a so-called Benard convection that occurs, and it sets in spontaneously at a certain value of the driving force that the convection sets in. If you didn't know that that happens before, you would not have been able to predict when it's happening, and you are also not able to predict at which rate now the heat transfer is occurring, because you don't know the mechanism in advance. We see only that beyond a certain driving force, there is a disruptive change in the mechanism with which the heat is transferred through that, well, layer in this case. And this disruptive change leads to a significant increase in heat conducted through the layer. Now, this is for heat transfer. I can tell you same things happen for mass transfer. There, this convection that is induced is called Marangoni convection. It's the same principle, more or less. Also, some disruptive change that occurs beyond a certain limit, and then suddenly things occur, and mass transfer is enhanced significantly. If we transfer that to migration, we can say if the driving force, that is the anticipated difference in style of living between poor and rich countries, as viewed by the people living in the poor countries, if that is exceeding a certain limit, there can be a disruptive change to a new mechanism of transfer that occurs, which will be much faster. We will not be able to predict when it starts, and we will not be able to predict how fast it is, and it will be surprising to us, as we can see from these mechanisms here. Because it's so general here for the mass transfer and heat transfer, we can transfer that also to other transport phenomena. That means in turn that suddenly at a certain difference, anticipated difference, there will be a significant increase in migration. And I think actually we reached that already, because we have seen, for example, in Europe, end of 2015, a strong increase in migration. Why? Because suddenly the people were walking on the highways. Nobody ever walked on the highways, and suddenly thousands of people were using the highways to get to the north, into the center of Europe, because there they expected better living. Similar things happened in through Mexico. So from Honduras to El Salvador, people walking and using buses to pass through Mexico to reach the Mexican, American, USA border, hoping that they can be transferring or partially diffusing, so to speak, into the United States. These are the things that are happening. We have to expect that these things are increasing, and possibly even new mechanisms that are showing up in the future if the driving force is too high. That means we have to put significant effort into developing these countries to decrease the difference in well-being in the different countries. We have to support these countries, because otherwise we will be getting problems with migration directly, more or less visible from these experiences in chemical engineering. With that, I would like to finish the topic of world population. That's a basis, so to speak, and now I want to build on top of that, on the one hand side concerning the energy transition, and then also look into food supply. First, the energy transition. I plot here the substitution rate versus time, where substitution rate means that how much primary energy supply is substituted by additional solar and wind energy in 1 year. That is, how much wind and solar energy technology have I deployed in 1 year, relative to the primary energy consumption in that year, so percent per year that are substituted with sustainable energy. And of course, it refers to the global average. I'm always setting up global balances here in evaluating global values. Okay, the substitution rate has developed like that in the past, and of course, we can project that into the future at certain rates mentioned here. And these are three scenarios, three energy scenarios or sustainable energy scenarios with which we can look into the future. Again, can then see how that does a system behave. Of course, there has to be a limit, because if that would grow arbitrarily, for example, we would reach 10 and even more percent of substitution rate, what would that mean? That would mean that in 1 year we would substitute 10% of our primary energy technologies with renewable energy technologies. And beyond a certain limit, that is simply economically not feasible anymore. I personally believe that around 3% is the upper limit. And that's actually worked out and explained in more detail in one of the detailed videos in this playlist. So I think that this is more or less the upper limit. Now we can look with these three scenarios that are shown here, how we can master the energy transition. And this is shown in the next slide here. Here we see the carbon dioxide production in gigatons per year as a function of time. These are the historical values, and if we don't change our energy system, we will continue something like that. The CO2 production, of course, directly relates to the amount of fossil resources that we are burning, which we are then using energetically, and of course the CO2 stemming from that burning process that is then released into the atmosphere. And if we now look at that and see what we can do with the three scenarios that I have shown in the previous slide, we would getting these energy scenarios. So this is the substitution that is then occurring. So we are decreasing continually the CO2 emissions by substitution with sustainable energy technologies. And we see that with the three scenarios, we can somehow reach those climate goals that are agreed in the Paris Agreement, somewhere between 1.5 and 2 degrees centigrade. And in agreement with other studies, we need to finish the energy transition by roughly 2050 if you want to reach the 1.5 degree centigrade goal, and by 2075 if we want to be somewhere in the range of the 2 degree centigrade climate change. With this diagram, one can now discuss various aspects of this transition. On the one hand side, we see that we will pass through the maximum of CO2 emissions only in some few years. The reason for that is actually that currently world population is growing quite strongly still. Also, the more regions are developing, which means more energy consumption per person. That's the increase of energy that or fossil resources that we are consuming. On the other hand side, the increase per year of sustainable energy is lower than that. So only if we increase that, it will match at a certain point and intersect with the curve of the energy that we are the increased energy consumption that we currently have. And only then we will reach a maximum. And then after that, CO2 emission will decrease, or also the use of fossil resources will decrease. That means, of course, now on the other hand side, if we use beyond that maximum less fossil energy carriers, the demand won't the demand is decreasing, but the supply will not changing so dramatically, not within few years by such large factors, which means actually that this interplay between supply and demand will change, which means the price will drop. Dropping price means, of course, on the one hand side, that the expensive technologies to produce fossil resources or to recover them from the ground, for example fracking, will not be feasible anymore economically. Of course, countries may subsidize that, but on the other hand side, that means subsidizing economies or technologies which are getting obsolete within some few decades. I don't know if that is a good idea, actually. It destabilizes these countries in the global interplay, more or less. On the other hand side, if the fossil resource price will be decreasing, that means that even though the fossil prices are decreasing, we need still to keep up our efforts for implementing additional sustainable energy technologies. So even though the conventional energy is getting cheaper and cheaper, we have to implement more and more sustainable energies. That will be a big challenge, economically speaking, especially if we see that during those times we have to rebuild major parts of our industries, energy industries, automotive, we have to build electrical cars, chemical industry, because the input has to be different. It can't be coming from crude oil. It can only be biomass or CO2 from the atmosphere. And also we ourselves have to invest significant amounts to insulate our houses better, to buy the electrical cars, to exchange our heating systems so that they are electrically driven, heat pumps or something like that. They should be efficient, of course, as well. So all this means money that we take into our hands, which means on the one hand side, due to the fluctuations in the prices that are foreseeable with respect to the fossil resources, the fluctuating amounts that are available, which lead to a vulnerability of the overall economy. Nevertheless, we have to have enough money available to pay for the sustainable energy transition. So that will be economically quite challenging times. And at that point, we of course have to really consider what are we doing with the money? What are we investing that for? Do we want to improve the performance of diesel engines? Or do we preferably do more research to be better with our electrical cars and get them into the market earlier to replace the diesel engines? Of course, that is a societal question because, I mean, the emissions in the cities from diesel engines are quite high. People are living there, and now you have to find a societal agreement, so to speak, what is more important, reduce the emissions in the cities or get more electrical cars on the road? That's a societal question that has to be answered. Now, what do we need to do? We saw it already a little bit in the previous slide. Let me work that out in a little bit more detail. We see here the substitution rate now on the one hand side for the world, on the other hand side for the EU. These are the goals that I mentioned, 2% to reach a substitution rate to reach the 2 degree centigrade goal, 3% to reach the 1.5 degree centigrade goal. So that's where we need to go. This is the last value that is available in the literature, 0.5% per year, which means we have to increase our efforts as compared to today by a factor of 4 or even factor of 6 if you want to reach the 1.5 degree centigrade goal. A significant increase in efforts that money that we have to put into the sustainable energy transition worldwide, all countries, also developing countries after all, at the end. At the same time, we realize that especially for the EU, that's leveling off somehow. Where is that coming from? Can we understand that? And what's the reason for that? Well, there may be several reasons. One reason definitely can be explained on the following slide. Here we see the electrical power that is supplied on different days, so versus time in 2018, and the different types of energy from which that has been recovered is mentioned here. So hydro energy, biomass, nuclear, brown coal, hard coal, the renewable energies, wind and solar, which are the largest contribution, more or less. Renewable contributions are shown here in orange and this bluish violet area. And we see that, of course, these solar and wind energies, they are strongly fluctuating. Solar only during daytime, not during nighttime, apparently. Wind energy, for example, in the first days of the year, quite significant. And even to me, surprising was that if we have such a high supply of renewable energies, the conventional energies, even the nuclear power plants, are downregulated significantly, only half the power, so to speak. That means, on the other hand side, that if there is an excessive supply of renewable energies, the fossil energy technologies, the power plants, have to be downregulated. Of course, the capability to downregulate them, to adjust them, so to speak, to the supply of renewable energies, that is limited. Beyond a certain limit, it doesn't make sense to implement more sustainable energy technologies, because you can't really economically use that, because the capacity to downregulate the fossil power plants doesn't work anymore. That's limited. And that's, I guess, one of the reasons why the efforts in the EU are leveling off. Because what we would need actually to overcome that is a storage capacity. If you were able to store the sun energy from day to night time, or to the wind energy in this during that time to some later times, then we would be able to use the energy much more. We could build more wind power plants, more solar power plants, and then store that energy and use it at other times where there is less wind or less sun. So what we need is really to implement more storage capacity for electricity. And there are ideas available. The technology is in principle available. For example, if you think about electrical cars, they all have batteries, so the battery capacity of these cars is quite high. And you can possibly, well, one idea is to sell to the car drivers only, or the car owner, only 80% of the battery capacity, and use the other 20% if they are plugged into to the outlet for the storage and release or energy supply variations. So when there is solar energy and the car is plugged in, you charge it to 100%. If you are then in such a valley, then you use these last 20% of the battery from that car to supply the valley of the supply of renewable energy. So you can then use that battery capacity to supply the energy. So that way, with all the cars, you have a significant storage capacity. There are other technologies available, gas pressure in caverns and other things that are possible to perform certain storage. Here actually pumped hydro storage is used already in Germany. These are the German values I didn't mention that, I guess, where you have certain variation, but the capacity of that is actually limited in Germany. It is more or less used completely what is economically feasible in Germany. So we need more storage capacity. That's one thing. The second thing is actually induced a little bit. What I want to discuss now is induced by the observation that in the last big climate conference in Katowice, last as compared to or relative to where I record this video, in Katowice actually there was lots of negotiation of how to bookkeep the CO2 and what to do with that, and no agreement was achieved. So instead of looking more into how we can foster sustainable energy technologies, there was some bargaining about some stupid side effects, more. Well, it's not stupid, but about some side effects of bookkeeping, more or less. And now the question is, of course, well, that means that we don't foster energy transition at the moment. We wait with that a little bit. What does that mean? What does it mean for the efforts that we need in the end? And we can evaluate that with the scenarios. As mentioned, if you want to reach the 1.5 degree climate goal, we need roughly 3% substitution rate, and if you wait 1 year, that effort will increase. This is this curve, and it depends a little bit on the population variant, high or low level, more or less. And for the 2 degree centigrade goal, we have this curve. You see that these curves are more or less horizontally shifted with respect to each other, more or less, a little bit tilted, but not much. And we can see here, for example, that if you wait only 5 years, instead of the 3% substitution rate, we would need 4% substitution rate. Maintain that over decades. And of course, it's a significantly higher effort. That means waiting any more year today is detrimental, is bad for the effort that we need. It just means we need significantly more effort in the future to reach the climate goals. And as I said already, I think the 3% is more or less a maximum that we can economically carry. Beyond that, I think actually it is becomes more and more so difficult that we can hardly master that on global level. And that means in turn that actually we are about to oversleep the 1.5 degree centigrade goal. Of course, the last IPCC report indicated that any tenth of a degree above that is making the system worse and worse, so we should keep as close to the 1.5 degree centigrade as possible. But there we would also, since all the curves are only horizontally shifted, we would already also be in a relatively steep part of the curve. That means we need to foster energy transition directly if we don't want to increase temperature significantly beyond the feasible limits. Now, in order to characterize a little bit the magnitude of the task, I show this diagram. Here I show the fossil and nuclear energy. Also, nuclear is of course not sustainable because we don't know what to do with the nuclear waste, apparently. We have a certain amount of hydro, so this is the primary energy consumption that we have in the EU as a function of time, apparently. We always had a certain amount of hydro energy, significant, only slowly increasing. Some bioenergy, some geothermal energy, and then we have this little range here, which is solar and wind, so this red and the bluish one. And this now we want to increase to cover all that. And that shows a little bit the magnitude of the task that is in front of us during the next few decades. All this, 20 or 30 years, and then that should be done if we want to reach the 1.5 degree climate goal. It's a big task, a really big task, apparently. So with that slide, I would like to finish that. I have shown it's possible, but it's really, we need to put effort into that instantaneously and significant effort, and then we can master that, otherwise we won't make it. That was one of the aspects. The second aspect that I already indicated a little bit in the first slides of this video are related to undernourishment and hunger in the world. We have seen that curve already, the number of undernourished people in million versus time. What I did not work out until now is this red dot here. This is the new goal in the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which were agreed upon, which were ratified in 2015. Now, I'm an engineer again, so I see this behavior. So if we don't change our behavior, we can decrease that also in the future, possibly a little bit, even if there's some intermediate increase, wherever that may be coming from. But that goal, that appears to be quite unrealistic. The question is, so to speak, now, as a consequence, what do we need to do to get here? Now, in order to characterize that, we can look at the land area that we have available and what we do with that land area. In order to characterize that, the first thing we need to regard is what we can get out of the land area. So I plot here the specific productivity in kilocalories per square meter and year as a function of time. So what do we get for crop? How many kilocalories on average do we get on a square meter agricultural land per year? And this is shown now for different cases here, or different subsections of the crops that we have. On the one hand side, seven major crops, then the overall vegetal primary products overall, and then the seven major crops subtracted from the overall. Now, what was striking to me is if we look at the historical data, which is the full line for these seven crops, which are the major crops that we use to, which have the major contribution to our nutrition. What was striking to me is that this is, in the historical data, a more or less a straight line, almost exactly. So this behaves like a straight line. Now, the overall, all crops together, not only these seven, but everything, has this curve, and you can extrapolate that with a straight line as well. And the rest is, of course, so the overall minus these seven major crops, that's all the vegetables, which are not contained in here, salads, asparagus, and things like that. So low energetic productivity per land area, apparently, and that's significantly below. Since that is a straight line, I assume also that here for the overall, production productivity, we can use a straight line to extrapolate that. And honestly speaking, I think that's quite an optimistic assumption, because if there is an effect, for example, of climate change on the productivity, so some bad harvest due to high temperatures or some extreme weather events which destroy the harvest, then of course that will decrease at a certain point. So if we assume this increase per time, and also this is for the plant-based but also for the animal-based production, assume increased productivity per land area corresponding to the historic development, then we can estimate the land area that is required for certain aspects in the future. And this is shown here. So here we have the land area in square meter per person as a function of time. In the past, we see the arable land, meadows and pasture, and the forests. And we see currently we are around 7,000 square meters for all agriculturally used land, which is roughly one soccer field. The white lines discriminate the different areas, so to speak, and we see that if we now just account for the increase in world population, it is this white line, how that is continued in the future. So that's the current area that is available divided by the increasing number of people in the world, and that leads to the overall decreasing amount of arable land that is available. Same for meadows and pasture as well as the forest. We see how much that decreases. In this case, for the high variant, the high option that or scenario that I used in the population scenarios in the beginning. And now we can look what we can do with the country, with the land area. We can produce plant-based food, we can use biofuels or biocombustibles in general, so also biogas, biomaterials, plastics, detergents, pharmaceuticals, feed, and pasture. And what we see actually is that if we add that up, we have to cross actually the white line. So we have to cut down a significant fraction of the forests, and these are all forests. All the primeval forests are included in here. We have to cut down significant fractions of our forests to feed everybody sufficiently, which is of course negative. Cutting down forests is negative. Now the question is, what can we do to overcome that problem? How can we nevertheless match somehow that we can feed everybody on the available land area? Well, one thing we can do is, of course, decrease population growth. If we do that, we get to this diagram here, where we see that actually the lower population growth, so it's now the lower limit of the scenarios that I've shown, that here we, the same addition, so to speak, we see that the per capita, because the world population is growing more slowly, we see these curves have been moving up, the decrease is less per time, but we nevertheless see that we are more or less working at the border. We are always operating at the limit of the carrying capacity of our planet, more or less, until around 2060, which means we don't have any excess land area available for bioenergy, biodiversity, or afforestation for CO2 recovery, CO2 fixation from the atmosphere. All that doesn't work up to here. So it's possible after that there is some more land area available, but up to here we have significant difficulties to, so it's not really sustainable at that point as well. What else can we do? Well, we see now, if we look in more detail, that we have here the feed, which is this magenta area, as well as the pasture. It's all for our animal-based foodstuff. All that, this large fraction of our area. And actually, we produce only 17.5% of our calories in the end on this land area, and this little bit of land area here leads to the plant-based food, which is more than 80% of our food supply. Which means animal-based food is extremely inefficient with respect to land area. If we would instead produce more plant-based food and would not use animal-based food, we would be much better off. The productivity would be much higher. And we can account for that, of course, in this scenario, so the high variant of population growth, but purely plant-based food. And I assume here that the transition to plant-based food is going along in parallel with the energy transition, so everything finished by 2050 in these scenarios. And there we see actually that we free a certain area here in that below, so from the meadows and pasture, but I assume that the different areas can be used interchangeably, as actually occurs because the arable land, the absolute value of the arable land is increasing, so continually pasture is converted into arable land at the moment. So it is interchangeable to a certain degree. So there is a certain area now becoming available, but if we look carefully, we see that that is getting less and less towards the end of the century. So that is fine, but still not really sustainable over extended periods of time. So we could deploy certain more bioenergy production, more afforestation and these things, but we would lose these areas towards the end of the century partially. And of course, if we continue like that, it would decrease, the available land area would decrease further. It is not sustainable on long term. Now we can do both things, decrease population growth to the medium population variant of the UN and consider purely plant-based food. And there we actually see very nicely that the overall land area that is required is continually decreasing until the end of the century, which is very good. And we have large land areas available. And of course, that's extremely positive because here we can do bioenergy, we can do ensure biodiversity, we can use afforestation to fixate the CO2 from the atmosphere, so we can support sustainable energy transition quite considerably with that. And these are really large areas. At the same time, we see that these factors, population growth and shift to plant-based food, are major factors. They are dramatic. Factor 1.5 or 2 concerning the land area that is required for food production. That are really big factors. And actually, keeping now in mind that we already assumed that the technologies are enhancing, or development in technological aspect on development of our seeds, so to speak, of our crops, that actually is assumed already to be increased on a high rate, continuing our historic trend, so to speak. It is not to be expected that any technological advancement is allowing us to not implement one of these aspects, because it could be compensated by any technological advancement. That's simply not expected, that any technological advancement could substitute these effects. Okay, that means actually we need to do that. There's no way around that. Now, if I say that, of course, you will ask myself, well, what is the basis and can we believe that? I want to show you how simple these considerations actually are. And this can be, I dare to show an equation actually here. Can be shown with this equation, where we simply say the land area times the production per area is the overall global production of foodstuff, for example. And we can compare that with the number of people and the calories demand that everybody has. So somewhere between 2,000 and 2,500 kilocalories per day and capita, depending on, so per person, depending on the climate and the how much physical work is that person, so to speak, performing in his job. And you see how simple that actually is. Yeah, land area times, that's what's available and that's what is needed. And then we can ask ourselves, do we have more available than it's actually needed? It's that simple. Of course, I evaluate that in a slightly different form. I divide by the production per area. So I get the land area is required is number of people times the calories divided by the production per area, and then I get this land area, which I then add up for the different uses as in the previous slides. And now we can ask ourselves, well, which possibilities do we have to influence that? We can't influence the calories demand so much, unless everybody would just be sitting in front of his computer and doing office work more or less, which is not to be expected. Then we can look at the different things. Land area, for example. If you would have less animal-based food, less pasture would be required, obviously. We have more land area available for other stuff. If you want to have more bioenergy or more biodiversity, we have less land area available for food production. Also directly understandable. Then the productivity per area, again, if you would have less animal-based food, I didn't mention that previously, I will show that later in an extra diagram, the losses from feed to food, which is roughly a factor of 2, would be decreased if you would directly eat the plant-based food, instead of first feeding it to the animals, which of course have their life processes that they fire, so to speak, by the feed. That always leads to these losses, and we can avoid them if we have less animal-based food. The number of people on the other hand side, which is the last factor here, can of course be influenced by the birth rate, that is the number of children per couple, and that can lower the number of people globally, so the world population. So we see how simple these interrelations actually are, how easy you can understand them, and then we can discuss, well, what else can we vary? Where the land area is more or less given, we are fighting for that, we saw that more or less, there's a competition for that. The only thing we can possibly discuss a little bit is the production per area. And if you believe the companies who are selling you genetically modified seeds, seeds for genetically modified crops, then they tell you, well, we can enhance the productivity significantly. We will solve the hunger problem. Let's look. These are the data for United States and Germany for the area-specific productivity as before, as a function of time, where in Germany GM maize is forbidden. It may not be used. In United States, during the last 10 years, more than 80% of all maize is genetically modified. So essentially all, plus minus. The GM crops could be harvested since 1996. And we see that actually, especially during the last 10 years, we see actually, well, we see it before, the two curves are more or less identical, have their fluctuations due to weather events, but they are continually increasing as we would expect from the previous considerations. And we see the fluctuations in the different countries are quite similar. And we see actually also during the last 10 years where we have now the comparison between GM maize and non-GM maize, the increase is comparable, the fluctuations are comparable. So neither does the genetic modification lead to an increase in productivity, nor does it increase the or decrease the fluctuations that you have, so the resistance to worse weather or things like that. So it doesn't change at all. GM food does not increase productivity or change productivity at all, at least not those modifications that have been introduced in the past. So the promises of GM food have not been kept up to now. So that's not the option, that's not the solution. Again, no technological advancement can overcome those factors, can be only as close to the magnitude of the factors of world population, limitation of world population, and on the other hand side, shift to plant-based food. Now, with respect to the plant-based food, I mentioned that the feed is actually converted into animal-based food with a loss factor of roughly 2. This is indicated here. So we see here the calorific contribution stemming from the original feed, so foodstuff, feed, other uses, bioenergy, for example, waste of the order of 5% and a little bit of seed, of course, that is required. And the feed is now decreased by feeding it to the animals who live from that energy, so to speak. And the output is then only this factor of roughly 2. If we would instead use that directly and feed it to the people and not to the animals, we could increase the caloric supply for our human nutrition by roughly something of the order of 18%. Now, of course, we won't eat exactly what the animals eat, so there will be some shift, of course, so it is not possibly 18%, possibly it's only 10%, but we have seen actually every single percent would count, and that would also, so to speak, add on top of these things that I mentioned previously. So globally speaking, we actually have to ask a certain question, and we can see that question actually on this next slide, where we see on the one hand side, if we have some crisis intervention by the UN, for example, the people get something like that, some cereals, some few vegetables, you can hardly see that in here, some coconut mash that is added to supply some fat more or less, and that's it. So that's what these people get at the poor end of our world society. Me, I'm vegan. This is what I have for options at my kitchen. So this has really been photographed in our kitchen. And you see, it's quite diverse, I can tell you it's quite tasty. I'm not lacking anything. Do we need that? Do we need that, especially if we take into account that using that actually implies that on the other end, due to the competition for land area, on the other end of the world society, we directly imply that. Is that ethical? You have to answer. Or actually society has to answer. I found my answer personally already, but society, which is of course has to come to agreement with respect to a general ethics, a sustainability ethics, has to answer that question. Now with this slide, I would like to end the chapter, so to speak, on foodstuff, on nutrition. And now I would like to start collecting the information a little bit and coming to some conclusions. Before I do that, I would first like to show this diagram where I show three different players in the game, so to speak. Us individual citizens, that's me and you, so in front of your screen. Yeah, so you are also individual citizen. Then there are the politicians and then there are company managers. And we can see that there is, of course, a quite nested interrelation between them. We elect our politicians, at least in democracies. We hope that they properly organize our lives. We have our demands, which are then supplied by the companies. And we assume that politicians control the companies. And of course, the companies or the managers negotiate with the politicians that this control is not getting excessive. There are some other players in the game that confuse everything a little bit. I don't mention that. I work that out in more detail in the longer versions of the videos in this playlist. And now one can directly say, these are the main players. They are in control because the individual citizen decides based on his free will, on the conscious choices he or she is doing, whom they elect, what they accept for political measures, and what they buy, what they request from the companies. And one can directly say it's not the other way around. It's the individuals who elect the politicians because, for example, in Germany, the Green Party 2013 proposed to have a veggie day once a week, only in public canteens. And the election results directly dropped. So it's not the politicians who can have good sustainable ideas and the citizens are then happy about that and elect them. No, it's not so. They have to go first, the individual citizens, change their worldview, and then the politicians can take that into account in their in what they decide, so to speak. Same here in with individual citizens and the company managers. Quite recently, where I record this video, German supermarket has wanted to shift the bananas to completely fair trade bananas, but they were not bought. So actually, that was a flop. That means actually, again here, it's not the company managers who can have good sustainable ideas, which they then sell to the citizens. That doesn't work. Yeah, we have our demands, we decide what we want to buy, and then the companies will simply supply that. So we are in the driver's seats. It's our conscious free choices that decide how this entire system develops. That means in turn that we have to take care of the stable, sustainable development because nobody else is, and nobody else can actually take that into account in his or her conscious personal choices as politician or as company managers, as long, at least not as long, as we are not going along with that. So we need to take the systems view in order to really realize how the interrelations are and then act, decide accordingly. Having said that, we can come to sort of first slide with conclusions. I mentioned that the reaching the climate goals is possible with available technology, of course, further developing that, sure, making it cheaper, making it applicable on larger scale, and that's exactly what we need. We need to systematically apply that on larger scale, but we need to instantaneously, significantly increase the global effort if we want to reach the climate goals as compared to today by a factor of 4 to 6, depending on which climate goal we would like to achieve, preferably 6, because that would limit climate change to 1.5 degrees centigrade. And we have to keep up that effort until 2050 or 2075, again, depending on the climate goal that we want to reach. At the same time, there's a second big challenge directly linked with that, which is a food supply, which is critical. And that is not a question of technology, but mainly a question of individual choices, that is of behavior. Here I assumed in the scenarios that I have shown already significant technological advancement, continual technological advancement. And of course, that's one thing here. On the other hand side here, the technology for the climate change or for the energy transition, of course, also their behavioral aspects are positive. If there are less people, we need less energy and we need less food. We have more land area available, as mentioned, for bioenergy and things like that, which ease the sustainable energy transition. The individual choices are exactly the number of children and the plant-based food that should be preferred significantly. More or less shifted completely to that, to plant-based food, because then we would have arbitrary or large land areas available for all these things that we actually want to do. We want them, but we don't, until now at least not, draw the right conclusions from that for us individually. without the behavior change, actually bioenergy is unethical because of this issue fuel versus food that you can see from the land areas and how they are used. We see that we have to come to a systems view instead of focus on own interests. And we mentioned already that there can be developmental tipping points, which are possible, which are of course detrimental, where we should foster development of less developed regions because that's also positive for the overall system, that is also for us. We are individually responsible. It's not just a question of politics and technology. And finally, on this slide, it has to happen now. Otherwise, the situation will get bad, and I don't mean just worse, but really bad, during our lifetime and that of our children. So I'm not the youngest anymore, but I will experience the consequences of that quite personally. I'm quite sure about that. Within some few decades, things will get worse if we don't manage. Now, again, if we lean back, so to speak, and look at the entire system, we have to realize that our system is quite limited. Here it's coming up. It's just this little marble ball, so to speak, that is flying lonely somewhere in the universe with a very tiny, thin atmosphere. And that's all that we got. No more land area available. No more sunlight available. No more resources available. That's it. And if we see it like that, and that's what the astronauts tell us more or less, the insight that they get looking at our planet from the outside is, actually, if we lean back and see, well, we are living on that, you and me and all the other human beings, and we just want to live well. We want to live a happy life with sufficient food, with sufficient shelter, and everything should be fine. No more than that, actually. And that, of course, means that we need to ask the question the other way around, more or less. How can we achieve that? And it's not so much, well, I'm here the big boss or whatever. That's not the issue. We all just want to live well on this, our happy private life on this planet Earth. And with this different perspective, we can now look at these things from a different direction, possibly. Again, I should mention, for the world population, I used realistic scenarios, so also worst-case scenarios, different from more or less all major other studies. I use a relatively optimistic land area productivity. I've shown that genetically modified crops don't change too much with that, or don't change anything until now. I have shown that we need to take a systems view. I've shown that the things are interrelated, competing for land area, and I have shown quantitatively how that happens. And I have shown that actually it can be understood even quantitatively. I've shown the equation, how simple that actually is. I have shown that well-being of us depends on the well-being of others. We need to develop other countries for that. And in the end, of course, this entire next topic, so to speak, that the behavior is at least as important as technology, and that applies already today, just to remind us, more than every 10th person is starving today on this planet Earth now here, only at the other end of the global society, possibly. That is, sustainability depends on us individually. It is not only politics, but largely also us who is decisive for that. Which means, in turn, we cannot delegate our responsibility to politics simply because it's our choices for which we are responsible, and we can't delegate that to others. And now I should mention also something about these new grassroots initiatives, Youth for Future or Fridays for Future or Scientists for Future. They are required. I'm happy about them. Why? Because with such a grassroots initiative, the citizens can realize how difficult the situation actually is and become aware of the problem, about the consequences of the problem. But one thing I'm more or less missing in the discussion, in the media presentations of these activities, they should tell the whole story, that it's us who have to change. It's not important only to, at least not only important, to demonstrate in front of the parliaments. It's us who have to change, who have to change our behavior, who have to change our individual personal choices. And one needs to tell that to the people as well. Finally, I would like to mention that there's no right to have rights. If you think how these rights came about, it was more or less, not really a negotiation, but agreement tacit agreement possibly what we can do, what everybody of us can do, and the other ones can, other people can do the same more or less, and then everything works out nicely. Since we are living now in a limited world and we see that us claiming the right for eating animal-based food means on the other end that the people have only little food available, that means that we have to renegotiate possibly. That needs to be negotiated. At least society has to come up to with a conclusion for that, if that is really right to eat animal-based food. But that's again a societal question, not mine. It will lead to a certain sustainability ethics, of course, and we have to realize that every single person has to follow such a sustainability ethics because everybody is equal with respect to an ethics. Ethical applies to everybody. So not only because, or not because we can buy, because we have the buying power to buy meat, does not directly imply any right for us. Ethically, that may not be appropriate. Same with the number of children, actually. With the children, I should of course say again that it's important that every child should be welcome. That's quite important. But on the other hand side, parents may not be proud anymore of having many children. That may not be. But the child can't do anything about being born, so the child doesn't have the choice. So we have to welcome every child on this planet Earth. With that, I would like to finish, so that are the last words containing content, more or less. The last thing that I would like to mention is that there are more resources available that I have supplied, so to speak. On the one hand side, the entire YouTube playlist with all the details of assumptions and more conclusions, more or less, and interrelations. Then a website which, in written form, shows in English and German more or less all the details in some detail. Also many of the graphs that I've shown here. And for those who are philosophically interested, there's a book available that I have written, which is taking care of more or less the philosophical aspects. It's written in German, so you have to be sufficiently fluent in German, I guess. And you should be interested in really philosophical questions because it's a relatively dry stuff. The question is asked, why are we responsible? Simply because we have free will. We have free will, how where does it come from? If on the other hand side we have physical laws that determine everything, how can that be understood? And that is worked out in this book. Also, I have to mention that I have written a publication in a scientific journal, ChemBioEng Reviews, June 2019 edition. There is an open access paper published where you can download the corresponding PDF and the supplementary material which is available. And many of the diagrams that I show in these YouTube videos are actually presented also in that publication. Okay, with that I'm more or less at the end of this video. I thank you for joining me up to here, to stay with me up to here. I hope that I could give you some insights into the interrelations with respect to sustainability and what we should actually be doing. I hope to see you again in one of the other videos, and well, at the end of the video, the only thing that remains for me to say is actually, I wish all of us, you and me, a happy and successful future. Thanks and bye-bye.